Most modern receivers nowadays come with their own calibration system, whether that's Odyssey, MCACC, YPOW, or what have you. And what that receiver's calibration is attempting to do is to give its best shot at tailoring your speakers to your room. But not every bit of calibration is good. What I want to show you guys today is how to go back behind calibration and correct its mistakes so that you can get the best performance out of your receiver. Now, a lot of people, they run their microphone, they set it in their spot, and they do the calibration, and they leave it there. They never once think to go in and see what it did. But today, I want to go in and take a look at what mine does and what I've done to correct it, and most likely, you'll be able to apply the same concept to your system and your receiver or AV processor. So I have on the screen behind me here, we're going to fire up the screen, go through what the settings are, what they do, and why they're possibly incorrect, and then how to correct them so that you can get the best sound out of your receiver. Now, before we get started, I do want to say that going back in and tweaking your setting is really up to you, your ears, and your room. So what I have here on my screen will not be what you guys have on yours, but going behind your receiver and fixing mistakes can really change the way that your system performs. You could find yourself getting a lot more sound than you thought was possible. So let's go in, take a look at what mine says, and then I'll show you how to fix them. So my calibration is already set, but what we're gonna do for the video purposes, I'm gonna grab my microphone to my Marantz receiver. Mine uses Odyssey XT32. So I'm going to put my microphone in the spot that it's supposed to be to calibrate. We're gonna rerun calibration so we get all new settings, and then I'll show you what it did and why I'm going to correct it. So let's go ahead and run calibration and we'll get right into it. All right, guys, so we just finished calibration, and what we have here, what you want to do after your calibration is go into your menu's manual setup. This is going to allow you to go back behind the system and clean up anything that needs to be fixed. So let's go into manual setup of the Marantz here. And the first thing you see is amp assign. You want to make sure before you do calibration that you have this set up. Amp assign just tells the receiver or AV processor how many speakers you'll be using in your system. So for me, I have a full Dolby Atmos setup, so I have mine in Dolby Atmos. And then it also allows me to tell it where my Atmos speakers are, whether they're in the ceiling, on the wall, or the modules on top of my speakers. You can put that here. So this is already set before we started. If you didn't know, you can also go to Amp Assign in your current system and go down to View Terminal Configuration. This allows you to see how you should be setting up your speakers. So it tells you where to input your speakers. So if you're confused on how to plug up your speakers to your system, if you go into the speaker configuration, it'll tell you what speaker terminals, what speaker outputs you should be using. So let's go down to speaker configuration, and this is where we're going to be able to set our speakers from large to small. Now mine were set to large. It had my front and my center set to large. Now this is incorrect. If you haven't seen my video on understanding crossover, go back and watch that video and then come back to this one, because that video will tell you why the speaker should not be set to large. So we're going to go ahead and change that to small, both of them, front and center. All speakers should be set to small. And it's not saying that you're using small speakers. It's allowing you to go in and set the crossover, which we'll do soon. Setting your speakers to large causes your receiver to send all frequencies, a full bandwidth, to that speaker, meaning it's getting sub-frequencies, it's getting high, mids, everything. And that could be dangerous, especially for a smaller speaker. So you want to set all your speakers to small so that you can go back behind it and set your crossovers. Now, distances is self-explanatory, and receivers and AV processors are actually pretty good at getting this generally pretty close. So for me, what you would want to do is have a tape measure, and you want to measure from the tweeter of your speaker to the listening position. Not from the back of the speaker, not from the bottom. You want to do it right where the speaker's tweeter is to the listening position where your ear will be, and that's your distance. So what I would do right now is grab my tape measure, which I'll do off camera, and I will set my distances. So then we'll see how close we get. So levels is a fun one. Setting your speaker level is a fun one. And you may want to download either an app on your phone, a dB meter, or get a dB meter from your local Radio Shack if you still have one, or some kind of Best Buy, or maybe even Walmart probably has dB meters. Get a dB meter for this one or a download one, because you're going to need it. So what receivers mostly try to do, most receivers, they try to set all your speakers to basically a 75 dB reference level. All your speakers down to 75 dB. So here you see all my speakers down in the list. You have values of plus and minus. And what it's trying to do is get all the speakers to play at the same volume level. So not only is the speaker reaching your ear at the same time important, but it has to also hit your ear at the same volume or you're gonna have unbalanced listening. So for right now, you can kind of see that no speaker is kind of set to the same value as the other. So for example, my front left is set at negative 7 dB. My front right is a dB louder at negative 6 dB. And why is that? Well, like we saw in distance, the speakers aren't the same distance away. So of course, the volume is not going to be the same either. So it has a dB boost to match its counterpart. The negative 7 front left is a little bit less than the front right because remember the front right was a little bit farther away than the front left. So it makes up for that. But what you want to do, you want to get a dB meter and listen to the peak noise that it plays. Peak noise sounds like this. You want to play a peak noise through all your speakers and make sure that they're at 75 dB or wherever you kind of want it. I wouldn't go too high. You don't want to go too high in the list here. You really don't want to go to the positive numbers because you may introduce clipping, and clipping is heat that destroys your speaker. So you kind of want to stay 0 dB or lower. But you want to go and get all your speakers 75 dB. So take a volume meter and measure 75 dB and then correct it so that every speaker is playing the same volume level. So these numbers don't need to all be the same. The left doesn't need to be the same as the right, but the overall volume that each is producing needs to be the same. So what I'll do is grab my phone, download a dB meter, and we will try to match the speakers together. All right, guys, so I got my dB meter out on my phone. I went through and changed everything, so I have mine set. So what you want to do is turn your receiver or AV processor up to 0 dB on the volume knob, and then what you want to do from there is check your dB meter and make sure that all the speakers read 75 dB. Now, if you like to go a little bit louder, then you can, but be careful turning your values up to the positive because you could get in trouble. I had to pretty much lower all of my speakers except my subwoofer. My subwoofer's playing just a little bit below 75 dB, but all my speakers were a little bit too high. So I had to lower most of them, and I brought them back down to the negative value. So again, turn your receiver or AV processor to 0 dB on the volume knob, take your dB meter, and then go through all the speaker levels and adjust them until you reach around 75, 76. I would go between 75 and 80 dB on all your values there without going too far into the positive numbers. And then your subwoofers, they're self-powered, so you can turn those up how you need them. So crossover is a fun one, and again, go back and watch my last video about understanding crossover because that's going to tell you what crossover does and why it's so important. But in this video, of course, we're going to talk about how to set it. So a good rule of thumb to set your crossover is check your speaker's manual or sometimes on the back of your speaker or on the website of your manufacturer. They will tell you your speaker's frequency response. And you want to usually set that around 20, 30 hertz higher than what's rated. So for example, my Canton Vento's A96.2, my front stage, those get down to 20 hertz. So I have mine, I would probably set mine to 40, 20 hertz higher than their lowest point. If you have a center channel or something, maybe you have a bookshelf set to, it says around 55 hertz. So maybe you want to set that around 70 or 80 so that your speaker still plays most of its response, but it's not digging really deep and potentially damaging the speaker itself. So go into your receiver's settings here, go to crossover, and make sure that you have it set to individual. I know some Pioneers don't let you set individually, or sometimes they don't let you set certain values. But you want to go to individual. That allows you to set all your speakers' crossovers independently versus having them set to all and they all play the same frequency. That's not what you want. So go to individual and you can set your speakers individually. So my front stage, like I said, my Canton Vento's get down to 20 hertz, so 40 is a good number. So I'm going to stay there. But look at my center channel. It has it at 40. And here's a red flag for me. The number one reason why I wouldn't set my center channel this low is because I don't want it trying to reproduce those low frequency bass. Now again, crossover doesn't stop at 40. When you have it 40, it doesn't mean that it's not playing below 40. It just starts to roll off at 40. So it'll still play 35, 30, 25. And those kind of low notes can really damage a small speaker. So that's one really big red flag. 40 hertz is just too low for most center channels. Another reason why 40 hertz is a red flag is because the male voice. The male voice typically sits around 75, 80 hertz for most men. Some with a deeper voice may go down to 65, 60 hertz. But really, no human usually speaks lower than that. So if you have a crossover that's lower than that, you may start hearing like a muffled sound through your center channel, or men or humans sound kind of like rumbly, like really, really, really grumbly like that. You just have a lot of bloatedness to your sound. So you don't want to have them cross too low, because they'll try to play frequencies that they shouldn't be playing. Also, you don't want to have it cross too high, because if you start to get to 100, 100 to 10, 120, you start to make your center channel sound anemic, kind of weak. So you start to lose detail and clarity in the human voice, and in some gunshots or action that's in the front of the screen, you start to make those sound very weak and anemic sounding. You want to leave it no higher than 80 hertz. Because you want things to be able to come through, but you also don't want to go too low, around 40 or so. So for me, 60 is a good number. It allows all the human ranges to come through, but nothing too much lower than that. If you have a scene with a dragon or something that has a really deep voice sound effects, they'll come through just fine, but it's appropriate for the content. Now, my surrounds are also a big red flag. 40 hertz is just way too low. You're not really sending that much bass to your speakers back there anyway, during a movie or during a soundtrack. But given that there may be a weird time where those speakers could receive that kind of frequencies, it most likely will harm your speaker at high volumes. There really is no reason for your speakers in the rear to be that low, because you have speakers in the front that should be capable, or a good subwoofer. So honestly, I'd probably set that around 80 hertz there. Front height set to 100, that's a little high for me personally. I like mine around 80 or so, 80 or 60. I have the Canton AR800s in the front, and then I have the Prime Elevations from SVS in the back. So they both get around 50 or so. So honestly, 60 wouldn't hurt. 80 would be a good number too. So you can kind of play with that. I'd probably set those to 80. And then my rear height, like I said, the SVS Prime Elevations, 80 as well. Now, you may have noticed that there isn't a subwoofer option on this list here, but if you're familiar with Odyssey products, you guys know that there is a subwoofer option for you on the next tab called bass. Now, if you have a different receiver, you probably have everything all in one list, but for us Marantz, Denon, and old Onkyo users, you may have to go to a different menu called bass. Now, so before we talk about how to set your subwoofer crossover, let me tell you a big no-no. You do not want to set your crossover on both the receiver and the sub. On most subs, you'll see that there's an LFE option where you can set the crossover to. Turn that dial all the way to LFE. What that does is bypass the subwoofer's internal crossover so that you can use it on the amplifier itself, your receiver or preprocessor. If you don't have a crossover option on your AV receiver or preprocessor, then you now can use that dial or that app or that tab on your subwoofer itself. Set it there. But if you have a crossover in your receiver, it's best to use it there and set your subwoofer to either LFE or turn it all the way up to its highest frequency so that it bypasses the subwoofer's internal crossover. The reason why you want to do this is because you don't want both fighting at each other to set your crossovers. You want one to set your dB level. You don't want both of them because you could add issues, sound issues. So be careful with that. So now, you first at the top, you see an LFE mode, a subwoofer mode. You have LFE or LFE plus main. I'm not going to go too in-depth with this because we did talk about that in my last crossover video. But you typically want to keep this at LFE. When you have it at LFE plus main, your subwoofers will play the LFE bass track in movies, but it will also play bass from the speakers. And this could cause a problem. This could also cause bloatedness, overwhelming bass. Cancellations, peaks, and nulls. So you want to typically put this as LFE. LFE stands for low frequency effects. Subwoofers have their own dedicated channel. They don't just play all the bass, they play what's sent to them. So LFE is their own dedicated channel. LFE plus main is still that dedicated channel, but now you're playing what all speakers are playing. So if the center channel has bass, so does the subwoofer. If the front height speakers have subwoofer bass, or has bass, so does the subwoofer. But that may not be what was intended. You may want the subwoofer to play certain things, and then you may just want the front speakers to play. It depends how the sound engineer put it. So typically LFE mode is the best mode. Now underneath you see the low pass filter, LPF, for LFE, low frequency effects. I have mine set to 120 hertz because some movies emphasize bass that high. So you want your subwoofer to be able to play up to 120 hertz at a given time. You won't often have your subwoofer play that high, but there are movies that call for it. So you may want to put it there. Most people cross it over at 80. That's a sweet spot. But if you want to get all the effects, make sure you set it up to 120 to get everything you need. Now, this should be a fun one for all my two-channel gurus here, or anybody who listens to their system in pure direct mode. Your receiver may or may not have this. But this is two-channel playback, and this is where you're going to be able to turn your subwoofer on when you're listening in two-channel stereo. I get comments all the time, how do I turn your subwoofer on? How? This is how you do it. Go into your receiver's menu, find something that says two-channel playback or pure direct mode or something of the sort, and you're able to turn your subwoofer on or off. If you have your subwoofer off, it automatically sends your speakers into large. That allows your speakers to play all the range. So if you're listening to two-channel music, that's what you want. You want your speakers to play all frequencies because you do not have a subwoofer. Now, if I set my subwoofer to yes, it now allows me to have a subwoofer when listening to two-channel speakers. If I'm listening to two-channel and I have a subwoofer, I'll probably change my speakers down to small. If I do, that allows me to change my crossover for them, just like we saw in a previous menu. If I have my front speakers set to large, it turns off my ability to cross them over to my subwoofer. So now my subwoofer is playing with my speakers. If I turn my subwoofer off, turn it to no, then just my speakers will be playing all the bass, which is typically what you want when you're a serious music listener. Now, if you have smaller bookshelves or satellites, or you just want a subwoofer on, I recommend turning your fronts to small. It automatically turns your subwoofer on, and then set your subwoofer down to LFE plus main. This will allow you to get all the bass to come from your subwoofer, or you can keep it at LFE, cross your speakers over at 80, and now you have a nice cohesive sound. So you kind of play with that how you like it, but this is where you're turning on your subwoofer. For me, I keep mine on no because I don't use my subwoofers during music playback. I like to listen to them as natural as possible with no extra help from my subwoofer. And then the manual setting, this is just how you change it from, if you want it, the receiver to automatically put it down to its own settings, and you can. If you want to change them, you can do that yourself there. And distance is already set from the distance and level. So that's how you set your two-channel playback. All right, so we have officially gone back behind Odyssey and corrected any mistakes. Now, if you don't have the Odyssey app, I do recommend getting it. It's $20. It allows you to go in and really fine tune your frequency response, your curve. What that means is that sometimes your speakers maybe have a peak or a null, and you want to use a professional microphone to calibrate that. You can use the app to change, hey, maybe you have a 80 hertz peak, you want to lower down 80 hertz, you can do that. Maybe you have a 45 hertz null, you need to boost 45, you can boost 45 hertz. That app allows you to go in and really, really fine tune if you want to use like an outside party, a third party app or something, maybe like a EQ wizard of some sort, you can do that. But that app is very handy. I have made a video on it called the Odyssey app for Denon and Marantz. I do have a video on that, two of them, going through that and setting things. So if you want to see that, check that video out. I'll try to link all those down below in the description for you guys. So with that being said, guys, that's how you're going to set your settings up after calibration. All right, guys, so that's going to do it for kind of how you go back behind your receiver and clean up some mistakes that it may have made. What's key is identifying the mistakes that it made. Some people just run calibration and then they sit back, relax, and watch the movie. But really, if you go back in there and fix some things, you can really bring your sound to life, make it a lot more lively, a lot more active, and you probably will like your sound a lot more and bring more out of your speakers. So definitely go back into your settings and see what you can adjust. Make sure that everything's correct. Now, I do recommend going into your app store and seeing your respective manufacturer's app for the receivers, because it allows you to go in and change a lot of different things that you can't change on the receiver itself. And it really makes a big difference. I go through and set my what we call a parametric EQ, basically an equalizer. You can go in and change so many different things to really tailor the sound the way it's supposed to be. Peaks and nulls, if you have problems with those, you can bring them up or bring them down. So check your manufacturer's app and see if they have one. It's definitely worth buying if you're somebody who really wants to get the best out of their receiver, AV processor, and their speakers. So guys, leave me a comment down below. Let me know what process processor or what AV receiver do you have, and what kind of, you know, what kind of settings do you have? Odyssey, do you have MCATC, YPOW? Let me know what kind of calibration system you guys have down below, and let me know if you've gone back and corrected anything. What did you find that was a mistake? Maybe crossover was wrong, or was your distance way off? Let me know down below, and I'll be happy to read about it. Leave me a like if you enjoyed this video, and hit that subscribe button if you're not already. We will see you in the next video. KPA Sky out. Peace.